I'm Tammy Cold, an applied mathematician, and this is Unlocking LaTeX Graphics. Today's episode is based on a question from a watcher. It's about creating blank axes that you could use, for example, in a quiz or some sort of other handout. I'm going to show you two ways to get the same result, one using TikZ and the other using PGFPLOTS. I think the PGFPLOTS version is more complicated, but also more flexible, but I'll let you be the final judge. This is one of a series of videos on TikZ and PGFPLOTS, and I urge you to check out the other videos in this sequence. These videos are based on my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, as well as some bonus materials. Here's the preamble for today's episode. I'm using Parskip and FullPage to make things look nice, hyperref so that I can link back to this YouTube channel. And then we include the package PGFPLOTS. This automatically includes the package TikZ. If you end up using the TikZ solution, then you only need the TikZ package, and it makes things a little bit simpler. If you use the PGFPLOTS, then it helps if you also use PGFPLOTS set and set the compatibility to an appropriate version. I'm using 1.17, and then also use the scale only axis option. I have a video on why these options are useful, and I'll link to that in the show notes. All right, now let's do things the first way. We'll create a grid and axis lines using TikZ. So let's suppose I want to draw a 2D grid with X values ranging from -9 to 9 and Y values going from -6 to 6. Let me go ahead and paste some code here to get us started. So the TikZ picture is the drawing canvas. The default unit in TikZ is 1 centimeter, and here I'm setting the scale to 0.5 or 50%, which means that the default unit will now be 5 millimeters. The first draw command lays a grid. So let me go ahead and compile this so you can see. With a lower left corner at -9, -6, and an upper right corner at the coordinate 9, 6. It's colored using ultra thin lines and gray at 25%. The next command draws the x-axis. It starts at coordinate -9, 0, goes all the way to 9, 0. It has arrows at the end, which is indicated here. And then it adds a node above and left of the endpoint with the axis label x, as you see over here. The command after that does the same, drawing the y-axis from coordinate 0, -6 to coordinate 0, 6, with a node below and right of that endpoint with the axis label y. Before we add the ticks, I want to define a tick label node style, so I'll go ahead and do this up here. And I'm making this tick label node style to be footnote size, and that's the main thing that I'm going to change there. And that doesn't change anything when I recompile. Now we can add something to create the ticks. So I'll go ahead and add that. We paste some code here. We're going to use some loops. I have a video on loops that I'll paste in the show notes. Here, the first loop is going to loop for each value -8 to 8 every 2, and it's skipping 0. For each value of I, it draws a little line from that I value at 0.15 down to that same I value to -0.15. And then below that, it creates a node using that tick label style we defined up here, and it puts down the value of I. And I'm putting it inside math font because that's what's typically done. Now here I'm just doing multiples of 2. I've had to write out the loop indices explicitly because I want to skip the 0. There's a few other ways you could potentially do that, but that's just sort of the easiest way for me. I'm doing the same thing on the y-axis using a second loop that goes j from -4, -2, 2, and 4, and it puts those tick marks here and then the labels over to the left. The main advantage of the TikZ approach is that you need very few lines of code to create a nice grid. The main problem is that any change requires multiple edits. If I want to change the x range to instead go from 0 to 18, this would mean edits in several places. So PGFPLOTS will offer some advantages on this front. Now let's create the same thing, but using PGFPLOTS. To start, let's create a TikZ picture and then an axis environment. In the axis environment, I've specified that the font of the tick labels should be footnote size. That's similar to what we did before. The width and the height of the axes are given, the X and Y labels, and then the min and max for X and Y. The result over here is a blank plot with automatic tick labels and X and Y. This is kind of interesting because I have a PGFPLOTS picture, but I don't have any add plot commands. The first thing we'll do is enable a grid, and we'll do that by adding the grid style up here. And so what I'm going to say is that the grids should be both. That means both major and minor. And then I'm going to go ahead and specify the grid style to be similar to how we had the grid style above, ultra thin and gray at 25%. When I compile that, we see that we have our grids. The first thing you'll notice, however, is that the grid is not at the same resolution. It's doing it at the major tick marks, but I haven't specified any minor tick marks, so we have to fix that. So let me go ahead and paste some code to go ahead and specify how to do that. I'm specifying both the tick distance and the number of ticks between major ticks. So here it says x tick distance equals 2, and the minor x tick num, that's how many go between, is 1. So this should always be the distance minus 1. Now, one thing I can do, for example, is if I change this to 3 and I recompile, and I only have 1 tick between them, that's not right. That is taking a step of 1.5. So I really need to change those in concert. So if I change the x tick distance to 3, then I want to change the minor x tick num to be 2. You'll want to change those together. Next, you probably want to have those axes in the middle as before. There's an option for that that we haven't covered before, and it's axis lines equals middle. This really needs to go before you define any other style. So I'm going to put it right here. And then when you compile it, you get your tick lines in the middle. The reason it needs to be at the top is it redefines a lot of things. It redefines the X label style, the Y label style, a bunch of other things. So do that first, and then everything else in your life will be easier. Now we can make a few more tweaks. Personally, I find it a little bit awkward that the arrow is ending at the tick mark. One thing that I like is just to go ahead and enlarge the axis limits a little bit. And so we have this enlarge limits option, which I covered a little bit in a prior episode, but I'm using it in a different way here. I'm saying that the absolute enlargement of these limits should be by 0.5. And so when I recompile that, you see now the grid stretches out just half a step further in every direction. So you get this nice little sort of grid running off of the page. Also, to ensure that the X and Y units are exactly the same size, these look pretty square, but sometimes they end up being messed up. I'm going to recommend that you go ahead and add this special command, which is axis equal image. And what that's going to do is it's going to fill it up so that it is either 9 centimeters wide or 6 centimeters high, and the units of the X and Y axis are identical. So here you don't see much of a difference, but you can see a big difference depending on what your X and Y limits are. One thing I do like about PGFPLOTS is that you can say how much space you have. If you want it to only be, 3 centimeters tall, you can say that and you'll have some control over the space directly rather than indirectly as in the TikZ solution. Now, to make the coding a little simpler, I would actually take a bunch of these pieces and put them into a style that I could reuse. So let me create a blank axes style, and I've just basically taken these first set of lines and put them into that. So I can delete that here and then just replace it with that style, blank axes. And now I'm only specifying here the things that are unique to these axes. And these are common elements that can be used over and over again. Now, one of the things I really like about PGFPLOTS is that it's very easy to change the limits and the intervals for the ticks. So for example, if I decide that I instead want my X to go from 0 to 18, I can do that and it's no problem at all. Boom, I have that. I didn't have to redo any loops or anything. Likewise, if I want to change my tick distances to all be 1 and these would then be 0, no problem there. I can just do that and now I get all those tick marks. You can make these changes very quickly and easily with very little effort. Thanks for watching today's episode on creating blank axes for worksheets. Please click like or subscribe if you found today's episode helpful. If you have other TikZ or PGFPLOTS questions, please post them in the comments. If you want to learn more, please check out the other videos. I also have a book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, available for purchase at major book retailers. Thanks for watching.